know, when I preach in, let's put it this way, when I preach in Bazungu churches in America, in white churches in America, I often have to tell them, this shouting thing is not an African thing. It is a Bible thing. The Bible says, shout unto God. You know, because oftentimes you get to a church and everyone is sitting and they are looking miserable. Then you say, clap to Jesus, and they all just... And you're thinking, hello? We are not clapping for the Queen. We are clapping for Jesus Christ. Amen. And the amazing part is, people will go crazy over a movie star. You see people really going crazy over one of those media, popular people in the media. Then you tell them to shout to Jesus and they're all being, they're looking miserable. Barely clapping, barely shouting. The greatest joy must be here in the house. Hallelujah. Amen. Turn your Bibles to Romans 12 too. Romans 12:2. This is a verse most of you know. Amen. It says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. I am an old style person. I read King James. So, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Let's read it together. And be, oh, do you have King James over there? Do you have the King James Version? Yes, now that's better. Let's read it together. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Hallelujah. One of the most important things as a believer is to understand where salvation starts. When you read the scriptures, you find something amazing. You see, Jesus said, not one jot or tittle of the word shall fall to the ground unfulfilled. Now, when you understand what a jot or tittle means, it means a full stop and a comma. God is literally saying even the full stops and the commas in his word are important. And it does matter. You know where you put the comma can change a statement? Amen. Because, for example, there's a scripture that says when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise a standard against him. You can decide where to put the comma. You can say when the enemy comes in, comma, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise a standard against him. Or you can say, when the enemy comes in like a flood, comma, the Spirit of the Lord. And the statement changes. Because it determines who comes in like a flood, the enemy or the Spirit. It matters. So God is saying, not even a full stop or a comma. Which means everything that is in the word is significant. Everything has been put there for a reason and a purpose. Amen. So, when you read the scriptures and you read the gospels, you find something interesting. When they describe Jesus' crucifixion, they say, and he was taken to a hill called Golgotha. And each of them puts in brackets, which means the place of the skull. Ask yourself, why do they bother to tell us what it means? What's so important about telling us what the word Golgotha means? Because in other places, they just tell you names of places, but they never tell you what the names mean. But yet, each of the gospel writers found it important to explain to you what it means. For one reason. The first place you need salvation is in your head. Yeah. And I'm going to show you. The first place you need transformation is here in your mind. Most of us, our sins have been washed away. That is true. But our mindset has not changed. Because we've not understood that salvation starts with a change of mind. Most of the time, we've grown up with a religious mindset. There are things they told us which are not true. Because when they told us repentance meant make a list of your sins. Father, yesterday I told a lie, I'm sorry. The other day I did this, I am sorry. When they say start repenting, people start listing their sins. But that's not repentance. The word repent actually means change your mind. What we call repentance is confession. Confess your sins, and he's faithful to forgive. But repentance, remember that what was the condition of salvation? He said, repent and be baptized. Meaning, change your mind, change your thinking, change the way you see things. See yourself different. That's what it is. Be transformed by the renewing of the mind. It doesn't say, be ye transformed by the laying on of hands. It doesn't say, be ye transformed by them putting anointing oil on your forehead. It says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And it says, renewing, present, continuous. Amen. And it says, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Proof. That you may become a living proof. That when people look at you, they say, that is, oh, so that's what God's will is. They take a look at you and they say, clearly we can see. That is what God's will is. When you look at, they look at you, that's when they see that, yes, that's God's good will. Ephesians chapter 1. Hallelujah. It's from verse 16. It says, I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that he may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. Amen. Notice, Paul had many things he could pray. Yet he felt the most, he doesn't say, I pray for you that you receive the anointing. He doesn't say, I keep praying for you that you may walk in great power. He says, no, I pray for you that you may receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Because he knows if you can get wisdom and revelation, the other things follow. Because what's holding you back is not that the power is not available. It is that your understanding is limiting how the power can work. So he's saying, I'm praying that you get this revelation, that your mindset changes. He says that you may understand who you are. How do I say? The glorious riches of his inheritance in the saints. That you understand that you have an inheritance. But here is the thing about an inheritance. To receive an inheritance, someone has to die. Amen. Yeah. You can't receive an inheritance until someone has died. And here is the amazing thing. Jesus died so that you can receive an inheritance. You already received it, because once he dies, they read the will. And say, they've left you this and this and this. Jesus died. You have an inheritance. In fact, you realize that scriptures that were said in the Old Testament were meant for us. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue that rises against you in judgment, that's Isaiah 54:17, you will condemn. What does it go on to say? This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. It is a heritage. You inherit it. But for them at the time, they couldn't actually access it yet, because Jesus hadn't died yet. Then he died, and now they could get into their heritage. You notice what he says. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me. By that time in the Old Testament, they did have righteousness. Because we become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He hadn't yet come and died, so they couldn't actually access that promise. It was for us. Heritage. But we must have our mind open. So he says, I pray the eyes of your understanding are opened, that you know the hope of his calling, the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. He says, what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe? According to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead, and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be head over all things to the church. Notice, he says, come to an understanding of what kind of power is available to you who believes. Then he goes on to even explain what this power is like. Now, sometimes we need to put this in context. Let's think about this power, because he says, this power which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his right hand. Do you know how much power it took to raise Christ? There was more power. It took more power to raise Christ than Lazarus. Yeah. I'll explain to you why. Because for Lazarus, the devil knew Lazarus would die again. You understand? The devil knew. Even though he's been raised, he will die again. But the devil knew this one thing. If Jesus rises, he's defeated forever. So you can be sure that the devil did everything he could do in all of his power to make sure Jesus doesn't come out of there. Which means that at the gates of hell, the devil mustered his entire army. It was there waiting to keep Jesus from coming out. In fact, I bet at that very moment you could not find a single demon anywhere. He had marshaled all of them at the gate to keep Jesus from coming out. All of it was gathered at this one point to keep Jesus from rising. Which means the kind of power it took to raise Jesus from the dead was enough to defeat the entire host of hell. And here's the amazing thing. He's saying that same power is available to you. Amen. That if you can get this revelation, there is not a single condition, there is not a single witchcraft, there is nothing powerful enough that even if the devil himself comes with all his top lieutenants and all of the whole of his armies against you alone, there is still more than enough power for you to defeat him. Because it has already been proven that it did. Amen. And this power wasn't just enough to get Jesus out of there. It was also enough to elevate him. Because that same power raised him. And where did it sit him? High in heavenly places, at the right hand of the Father. And and it doesn't just tell us that it raised him high. It even tells us the location. Amen. It says, far above all principalities, all power, all might, all dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world, but in that which is to come. So that's where this power raised Christ. And he's saying the same power is available to you. Now, when you move to chapter 2, verse 6, what does he say? He says, we are seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. Which means the same power that worked in him, when you believed, also elevated you and sat you in the same place. Hallelujah. So now just imagine. Do you know what it means? It means that also you are seated far above all principality, all power, all might, all dominion, and every name that is named, and that in this world and in the world to come. That's where you are also sitting, because it says you are sitting with him. So if that's where he's sitting, that's where you're sitting too. That's where you are. Now when you get this revelation, you stop mourning about the devil. You stop mourning about circumstances. You have exceeding power. The only thing limiting you is your understanding of it. That's all. Let's go to chapter 3 of Ephesians. Because I want you to see this. It says, verse 17. Actually, verse 16, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith,
And that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend. Hear that word again. Comprehend. It's a mindset thing. Comprehend. With all saints, what is the breadth and length and depth and height? And to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that ye may be filled with all the fullness of God. So which means the only thing you need to be filled with the fullness of God is understanding. That's it. That the only thing limiting you is understanding. That if you can just get a revelation, you can walk in the fullness of God. Now notice this. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. He doesn't say according to power that's working outside of us. Not according to power that's coming from heaven to earth. It is power that is already resident in us. So the great things God is able to do, he's able to do them using power that already exists inside you. Within you, there is already more than enough power to go beyond your imagination. More than enough. But you need to know it. You need to grasp it. It needs to stop being head knowledge and come into your heart. It turns into a revelation that you believe and you live it. According to the power that is at work within us. But notice it says, according to the power that is at work. Not power that is at rest. It's power that is at work. Some of us have a lot of power, but it is at rest. When we did physics, they taught us potential energy and kinetic energy. You look at this river, it has a lot of potential energy. Until you build a dam and you put some turbines in there, and this river begins to turn these turbines, you cannot get electricity. What happens? Something has to happen that converts all of that potential into power. There's something you must do to stir it up. Hallelujah. That's what our praying does. That's what our fasting does. That's what our getting into the Word does. We are running the turbines to produce power. We have the potential, but we must put it to work. Not the power that is at rest, the power that is at work. Convert your potential into kinetic energy today. Hallelujah. A lot of people don't know how much power they have because they've never gone out there to preach. You see, you're sitting in church and you are waiting for some experience that will tell you that you have power. You will not know until you go out there and preach. That's when you will have opportunities for miracles. Amen. Because you see, some people are waiting for the day the pastor will stand here and say, I feel it, you are the preacher for next Sunday. Guess what? This is not your mission field. This is the pastor's mission field to you. Yours is outside there. Amen. You go out there and that's when you see the power at work. I had never seen miracles while I was sitting back in my home church, working through me. Because it wasn't my mission field. Until I got out and I went out there to preach, then I began to see miracles happening. I had to get moving. I had to put it to work. So if you're sitting here waiting, you will wait for a very long time. It will just be potential energy, nothing happening. You must make it kinetic, make it move, put it to work. How will you ever see a healing if you never ask a sick person to come and you pray for them? It's not just going to happen just like that. You have to get bold and you say, come, let me pray for you. Amen. You know, sometimes we make it look so big. It is very simple. It is as simple as a workmate who tells you, man, my back is hurting. And you tell them, is it all right if I pray for you? It's that simple. I have never seen anyone turn down prayer. Even the ones who don't believe, when you ask them nicely, is it okay if I pray for you? They will accept. Nobody turns down prayer. There is your opportunity to demonstrate power. But we let it pass by.
One, because our mindset is limited. We are scared of the system in which we are. We are very scared of the system. We are afraid. The system has told us, don't say these things. You know, it could cause you problems. So we've allowed the system to hold us. Yet our God controls the system. Our God owns everything. I tell people in the U.S., you know, sometimes people are asking me all sorts of questions, and then I tell them, you know, you need to understand something. I am not an immigrant.
I'm not an immigrant. Maybe you are. I am not an immigrant. You know why? The earth and the fullness thereof belongs to my Father. Everywhere I go belongs to my Father. How can I be an immigrant in my Father's stuff? How dare you call me an immigrant when I'm living on my Father's land? I'm not. I'm not an immigrant. It's my Father's land. Jesus, I refuse to be called an immigrant. I'm not an immigrant. I'm not a refugee. I am not seeking asylum. Nothing. I'm simply moving around in my Father's holdings. I'm just moving around in my Father's holdings. Can't call me an immigrant. My mindset has to change. My Father owns all of it. I was in Peru preaching, and suddenly I saw a vision. And in the vision, I saw a dining table in a home, and it was loaded with good food. But the children were sitting on the floor and they were crying, begging for food. And then I came out of the vision. I said, Lord, what's going on? The Lord said, you are those children. You're children of the house. Everything in the house belongs to you. Children in the house don't beg for bread. They just go and pick it up. When I grew up, I never asked my parents for permission to go into the fridge. Whenever I felt I wanted something, I opened the fridge and I removed what I wanted to eat. Amen. When they would put food at the table, I didn't wait for an invitation to come and sit. It was obvious if they've laid the table and they've put the food, it is lunchtime. You come and sit down and eat. If anything, I would sit down and demand to be served. But then we come to God and we beg. Father, please, please, please. Every time I hear a prayer with please, I feel so sad. You a believer, not a beggar. Why are you begging? Why are you begging in your Father's house? I don't beg for miracles. I don't beg for healing. I don't beg for breakthrough. It is mine. What did Jesus tell the Sidonian woman? He said, I shall not give the children's bread to the dogs. Is that true? But as many as received him, he gave the right to be called the children of God. Amen. And as many as are led by the Spirit, they are the children of God. So if you're a child and Jesus is calling miracles bread, he's calling it the children's bread, then miracles are your bread. You're still supposed to eat them. They belong to you as a child of God. It is yours. Get that revelation, that understanding. You're not begging for it. It is yours. When you get that revelation, your life changes. I don't beg for miracles. I come to receive them. I'm a child. They are mine. In fact, the very reason miracles exist is because of me. They were put on the table so that I may enjoy them. Hallelujah. But when we move to these other nations, oftentimes there's a mindset that comes. You come into the nation and the people you find there tell you, you know, the system is designed to keep you at a certain level. You cannot break through certain things. The way things have been done, this is how far as you can go. And we start to believe it. I remember when my wife went to the U.S.
It was a student. Now, I don't know here, but in the US, if you've gone as a student, you can't work. You know, you don't have permission to take a job. So she gets there, but she needed to work. Like most of us, you need to make some money. They told her, the only jobs you're going to be able to do are those ones which are, you know, under there, under the table. And that means the only jobs you'll be able to do is work in people's houses and, you know, take care of some of these old people. And she first tried these jobs. She worked for some lady who treated her like trash. So she calls me one day and tells me, and I tell her, you know what? I don't care what they say. I serve a God of miracles, signs, and wonders. I am going to pray for you. You're going to get an office job. She said, but I don't have papers. This can't happen. I told her, who told you my God cares about papers? I fasted. I told her I'm going to fast 21 days. This thing is going to change. Fasted 21 days, and she somehow ended up in an interview. Someone called her, said, hey, by the way, there's a job at the company I work. I could come for an interview. She went for the interview. At the end of the interview, tells this guy, but you know, I don't actually have permission to work. This guy said, oh, don't worry about that. We'll work on that. They filed for her, and she got to work. Because she refused. We refused to accept the status quo. We refused completely. We said no. When you know that you are a child of the king, you can say, no, I'm not taking that. We were living in an apartment. Now, you can imagine, you know, it's one thing when certain things happen when you're in Uganda, but when they happen when you're in America, you start wondering what's wrong. We were living in a one-bedroom apartment, and what they call them? Bedbugs invaded the whole complex. Can you imagine bedbugs in America? You wake up in the morning and bedbugs have bitten you everywhere. It was miserable. I said, my God, even in my house in Uganda, I didn't have bedbugs. And now they are here in America. And you call the apartment complex and they say they are going to fix it and nothing happens. After a couple of weeks, we're like, enough is enough. Said, we need to move. But we still had a limited mindset. So we are thinking, you know, since we are moving, we'll upgrade. Let's now get a two-bedroom apartment. We were praying and the Lord said, enlarge your boundaries. He said, what do you mean? He said, I told you to go get a two-bedroom apartment. Go buy a house. I said, huh? Here was the problem. We didn't have a credit history. So we wouldn't qualify for a mortgage. And God is saying, go buy a house. Not only that, we were on visas. We were not even permanent residents. And he's saying, go buy a house. Said, okay, you said we'll go buy a house. We started looking around at houses. And again, we're looking for some three-bedroom houses around. You know, now we've upgraded from two bedrooms in our heads to three bedrooms. And we are looking around. As we are looking, the Lord says, don't get a small house, get a big house. You must house my people. Said, what? A big house. Now you're calculating, even if I get the mortgage, this monthly payment. You know, you're thinking many things. First of all, you don't know how you'll even get the mortgage in the first place. Now you're also wondering, if I get it, what happens next? We find this house. Now let me tell you, first of all, the house, when we got there, well, they just showed us the plan. They were going to build it to order, brand new. We sign all the documents applying for the mortgage and everything, and now let's wait on God. Do you know we got approved for a mortgage at the lowest rates ever? And here is the thing. When you're signing, there's these things they call closing costs. They are quite high. They're a couple of $1,000. This guy said we are paying the closing costs. The very guy selling us the house said we are covering the closing costs. And you see, here was the thing. The money we had was enough to either be a down payment. So when they said they're paying the closing costs, now this could become a down payment. And we get the house, and they built that house in 90 days.
from scratch. They built it up in 90 days. We entered this house. And everyone was wondering, how did you do it? And after we proved, you see, that's why it says that he may prove what is the good and acceptable will of God. Once we became living proof that this can happen, other Ugandans came and moved into the neighborhood too. They said, hey, you mean this is possible? All the Ugandans I knew at the time, maybe there were some others, but all the ones I knew at the time were driving used cars. I said, for me, I want a car where I'm the first one to sit in it. I said, I want to break this limitation. Why do we drive old cars? Let's believe God. We went to a dealership. Now, this one was another testimony, because what caused us to go to the dealership? And let me tell you, sometimes you're crying to God about a problem, but he's using it to push you to where you need to go. Because right after moving into the house, her car breaks down. And they say the radiator. And we are like, but Lord, the blessing of the Lord is supposed to make rich and not add sorrow. Now, we've just got a house, now we are getting sorrow with the car. What's going on? But we said, okay. So we first look around, and we first went to some used car lots, until that's where our level of faith was. Went to some used car lots, and the guys were telling us, ha, you never knew when you bought that car, it actually had an accident history. We can only... First of all, we bought it on credit. There was still 8,000 to pay on it. Now they are telling us they will only give us 4,000 for it. So we'll still owe another 4,000 and you still need another car. I said no. At the time I was in Uganda, I told my wife, go to a dealership. Because the car she had was a Nissan. I said, go to a Nissan dealership. She drives the Nissan to the dealership. Says, you know, I want a car. They're like, okay. How much do you have for a down payment? She says, well, I just want to trade in this one. I said, okay, let's go inspect it. They went and inspected it. Then the man comes back and says, I have an offer for you. We'll give you $12,000 for this car. So we paid off the loan on the other one, had $4,000 to put towards the new one. But you have to believe God. You have to break the limitations on your mind. Those limitations are what are holding you back. People have told you, this is what you can have. This is how far you can go. Who said? Who said? You can go higher. You can earn more. You can do greater things. Who said? I was walking on a street in Forest Gate. And they showed me, and I looked and I told the person I was walking with, these houses look bigger than all the other ones I've seen. You know, it was a street and the houses were big and people had Mercedes Benzes, you know, S-classes, latest models parked outside. And he says, yeah, you know, this whole street is all Indians. I said, hey, Indians, not white people, Indians. If Indian immigrants who don't know Jesus can have this stuff, why? Do we who have Jesus Christ settle for less? Why do we allow people to convince us that that's how far we can go? Why do we allow certain mindsets to hold us back? He even told me, yeah, you know, there are even some MPs who are Indians. It's like, hey, what are we Ugandans waiting for? Let's get some. What are Africans waiting for? Let's have some Africans in Westminster. Why not? You could be the one. Yeah. You know, sometimes someone tells you, you're thinking, the Bible says Sarah laughed. It sounded insane. She laughed. But is anything too hard for God? Why can't you be the next MP? Who knows? You become the next MP. Next thing you know, you're rising through the ranks. Next thing we know, you're the Prime Minister. Why not? Margaret Thatcher became a prime minister when no woman had ever been prime minister in this land. But let me give you an even bigger example. Who ever imagined 8 years ago that a son of a Kenyan could be president of the United States? And let me tell you, it's one thing if your father is the Muzungu and then your mother is the one who is Kenyan. Because at least your name will be Smith or something like that. But here you are, you are called Obama. Barack Obama. You don't even have John Obama or Peter Obama. But you are Barack Obama. And not only Barack Obama, you are Barack Hussein Obama. And you become president of the United States of America, the world's sole superpower. Why do you allow anything to limit you? We have examples even here. Who knew that an African, a Ugandan, born in Masuri, can become Archbishop of York? Second in the Anglican hierarchy. Who knew? So if God can do it for him, why can't he do it for you? And by the way, he never even studied clergy stuff. No, when he fled from Uganda, he wasn't a clergyman. He came here and he studied that stuff here. Then he rose through the ranks. Now he's an archbishop. Sits in the House of Lords. You know, they actually call him Lord St. Amu. He didn't even have to change his name and make it Smith. He's still St. Amu. And they say it. By the way, when God raises you, all the mispronunciations go away and they start to say saying it right. They figure out how to say it right. Now you are important enough for them to practice until they get it right. If they were having issues with it before. In fact, you hear him, the accent hasn't changed. And they listen. They listen. Why are you allowing limitation to hold you? What mindset is holding you? And let me tell you, there are many mindsets. It's a process constantly of breaking mindsets, breaking mindsets, breaking mindsets, saying no. I refuse this, I refuse this. And you consistently, because these mindsets, they didn't grow overnight. They grew over a whole childhood and adulthood. So you have to consistently fight the mindset. You have to consistently resist it, consistently speak what God says, not what you think. And the answer is in the Word. The Word tells you who you are. It tells you what you can have. It tells you what you can do. You have to keep reminding yourself. The word of the Lord says, I'm more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord says, he has blessed me with every spiritual blessing in high places. The word of the Lord says, he desires for me to prosper even as my soul prospers. You have to keep saying these things to yourself. Saying these things to yourself. Until your mindset changes completely. Once your mindset changes, says he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask or think. Can you imagine God doing beyond even your imagination? You know, that's something else. Because most things that happen, I can at least imagine them. But he's saying he can do beyond what I can imagine. Hallelujah. I once saw God do something I couldn't imagine. I was at church in Uganda. It was overnight prayer. Now, overnight happened in the morning. As they are taking up the offering, the Lord tells me, everything in your pocket, put it in the offering bag. I was a university student. Now, I put all the money in the bag thinking, well, the church had these double-decker buses. So I was like, I'll take the double-decker bus back to the university. Problem is, the power of God moved and I got slain and the bus left me. Now, by the time I get up, the bus has left me. I have no money. I actually began to grumble. I said, Lord, you are not fair. You tell me to give my money, then you put me down and the bus leaves me. You are not fair. And let me tell you, that wasn't the worst of it. I get up and I start walking. And the pastor is driving. And I wave and he doesn't see me and he passes me. So I continue trekking slowly to get all the way back to the university. Meanwhile, I don't know what will happen the whole of that coming week, because now I've put everything I have in there. At the time, it seemed, you know. So I get, as I am walking, for those who know Uganda, I'm walking on Sentema Road, you know, where there's
Pastor Kaiwa's church. Now, as I am reaching Pastor Kaiwa's church, I look at my phone, and it is 6:30 a.m. Then I do this. I look, I'm standing at the door to my university dorm room. I look at the watch, and it is still 6:30 a.m. It just transported me from one spot to the next spot. But you see, I would never have had the opportunity for that kind of testimony if, first of all, he didn't take away my money and let the bus leave me and the pastor pass me. Something needed to force me into a circumstance where the miracle can then happen. So that situation you're facing, it has just come so that you can go into the next level. It has come to push you to where you ought to be. So stop grumbling and start looking at it as a great opportunity for victory. Every situation around. Winston Churchill had lost elections until there was a war. The war came so that Winston Churchill's greatness could be manifested. We wouldn't know him today. He'd lost previous elections. But suddenly the war came. Now they needed a man like him. Hallelujah. That situation is there to propel you to your destiny. Turn your understanding of it. Change the way you look at it. The moment your mindset changes and you realize this thing has come to propel me to my destiny, you will know. Amen. And the things of God are interesting. Samuel comes and anoints David. And after anointing, you'd think that's it. They have poured the anointing. The greatest prophet in the land just showed up and anointed you. And they sent him back to his sheep. And when they send him back to the sheep, now a lion comes and a bear. Most of us would be saying, now what, God, what do you want with me? You were expecting that after the prophet anoints you, you should now be in the palace being prepared for being king. Instead, you're back in the wilderness and now you're being attacked by bears and lions. Then when your father sends you to take some food to your brothers, they're like, what do you want here? You, I know you. You're just looking to cause trouble. You just brought the guy some food and you just happen to say, but that guy is an uncircumcised Philistine. You're like, what do you want here? Now, because you've talked loudly, because I don't think David intended to fight Goliath. But you know, he's saying, this uncircumcised Philistine, you guys are afraid of him. Then they take you to the king. You're thinking, what did I say? Why did I say it? I can tell you that because that has happened to me before. You go to a healing meeting. Say, God is going to do great miracles today. Then you see someone, you're like, come. And you're thinking, doesn't look like a very big issue. Then they explain the issue and you say, oh my God. I saw a man with a walker. He was shuffling along. So I thought, man, God just needs to put strength back in his legs. I called him out to pray for him. When I called him out, the guy said, you know, I have no feeling at all in my legs. And there's no circulation. I have diabetic neuropathy. I said, Lord Jesus. Then I noticed he had all sorts of bandages on his feet, and he said, yes, and my feet. You know, because I can't feel anything, I poured very hot water on them and never noticed. And so he had these big wounds on the feet that are wrapped up. So I pray for him. And the Bible says, and David strengthened himself in the Lord. I prayed for him. Then the man says, I can feel my legs again. So I grab his hand to help him walk, and he even throws it off and just walks around. But here is the amazing thing. He tells his wife, we need to check these wounds. They checked and there was brand new skin. Amen. The situation has come because God knows you. He knows if you know what the condition is, you're not going to call that guy out. So he pushes you into a corner, so that he may manifest greatness through you. Because God sometimes looks at you and he says, this one, they're so comfortable in that apartment. The only way I can push them to go and own a house
is to cause some circumstances that chase them out of that apartment. The only way God can push you out of there so that you believe for something bigger. He looks and you've been comfortable with your VW Golf for the last 5 years. You're saying, this guy is reliable. I love it. It's always good. And he says, I want to give him a Mercedes. What do I do? Let me cause that Golf to have an accident. So that you can believe God for something bigger. Because you've gotten too comfortable. You're in a comfort zone. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 10. Is it 1st or 10? 2nd. Anyway, we'll see. Chapter 10. If it's the first one, I'll tell you. It should be 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Go on. Bring verse 5 up. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. You know, when we grew up, every time they would say spiritual warfare, you start battling with every demon in the heavenlies. I pull them down, come down in the name of Jesus. Yet the biggest part of spiritual warfare is in your head. He's saying casting down what? Imaginations. Where are they found? In your head. Every thought that does what? Every high thing that exalts itself against what? The knowledge of God. What is that? Mindsets, ways of thinking. It's all here. Then what does he say? Bringing every thought. It's here. It's here. If you can be delivered here, it will manifest everywhere else. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That is why the Bible says, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Your thoughts determine what you become. Hallelujah. Change your thinking today. Change how you perceive things. Change your mindset. You are a victor. You are more than a conqueror. You're not a failure. Amen. You're not defeated. You have power available to you. Change your mindset and everything else will change. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo, Lord, we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. Change our mindsets today. Change our mindsets today. Change our thinking. Transform us. Transform us. Transform us. Transform us. Transform us, Lord. Reko sopro derebo sikatababa kutomondelebro sakata. Let there be a breaking of every thought. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God in our lives, every mindset that is contrary to what God says about us, every thought that does not conform to what God says of us, we cast it down tonight in the name of Jesus. Today, my God, today, we cast down those thoughts, we cast down those mindsets, we bring them down in the name of Jesus. Every imagination, every thought we've had that does not match to what God says of us, we cast it down today. We break it down today. It ends today. In the name of Jesus, let it be destroyed. Let it be cast down in the name of Jesus. Oh, sekopredewo simanda labakaha. Father, expose our minds. Show us the areas that we need to change. Show us the things that we need to bring down. Show us the limitations. Take the limits off tonight, Lord. Today, take the limits off. Take the limits off. Take the limits off of our mind, my God. Lord, let the limiters be removed in the name of Jesus. The limitations in our thinking, the limitations in our dreams, the limitations in our visions, let them be removed in the name of Jesus. Let them be broken in the name of Jesus. Oh, we give you praise, Lord. Hallelujah. Let me tell you this. If you can achieve your dream by saving and planning, it is not from God. Because if it is of God, it should require faith. If your dream is achievable by just planning and you say, I will save like this for the next 10 years and then this, and this is my plan, that's not God. when it is God, it is so big it requires Him to make it happen. You just know you've missed it if you can do it by planning and saving. Amen. Break the limitations. Break the limitations. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us stand up. How many of you here, you need healing in your body? If you're here and you need healing in your body, hallelujah. There's going to be healing is simple. Those are the easiest things. Hallelujah. Sukarebo sibrahata. That's easy. Amen. Sikoriana man compredo sikata. Usekorimande sibrahata karabo subrahai. Jesus. Oh, Holy Spirit. Thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, Thou art welcome. He touched me. Oh, He touched me. And all the joy that floods my soul.
The mighty thunder.
time is not on our side, this is what we're going to do. But before we do it, I want to encourage you. Because, you know, sometimes people think the man needs to lay hands on me. But you don't need a hand from me. You need Jesus to touch you. My hand is just a hand. But the hand of God is something else. Hallelujah. Yesterday, there was a lady in a meeting. And just as we were ending to pray for people, she got a phone call from her daughter. And her daughter said, I have such a terrible migraine. I can't even see. I'm just seeing colors. I'm struggling. And she hadn't been working for 3 days because of the migraine. It seemed to have gone now. It had come back even worse than before. And she was like, this is more than a headache. It's everywhere. It feels like my head is about to explode. So I told the lady, let's pray right now. We prayed. And I told her, now call your daughter back. Called her daughter, and the daughter said, it has gone completely. I'm going to work right now. She wasn't there to be laid hands on. But the power of God met her even there where she was. Amen. So the power of God is going to touch you right here. I just want you to place your hand wherever the problem is. If it's a pain, if it's a sickness, whatever it is, place your hand where it is. And if it's one of those general conditions, you place your hand on the head. Maybe it's some kind of, you know, like diabetes, things like that, which are in the whole body. You can place your hand on the head. Because Jesus is going to do a miracle for you. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, you are a God of miracles, signs, and wonders. Yesterday, today, and forever, you are the same. You have never changed. You, the same Jesus who did miracles in Nazareth, the same Jesus who did miracles in Galilee, the same Jesus who did miracles all through Judea, you have not changed. You're still doing miracles. Even today, you are still doing miracles. You, because you are a God of miracles, signs, and wonders. And it is your will that your people be free of sickness. It is your will that your people be free of pain. It is your will that your people be in health. Therefore, in the name of Jesus, I stand by the authority that you have given me, by that incredible power that raised you from the dead that is available even right now. I rebuke every sickness and I command it to go. I command pain to go from their bodies. Pain go from their bellies. Pain go from their shoulders. Pain go from their arms. Pain go from their backs. Go from their limbs. Go from their legs. Go from their organs. In the name of Jesus. Every sickness go. Every stiffness go. Arthritis leave their bones. Arthritis go from their joints. Cancers, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I rebuke every sickness. Go from them and never come back. Sickness, I address you now by the authority given to me by the Lord Jesus. I command you, go from their bodies. Pain, leave them right now in the name of Jesus. Loose them now in the name of Jesus. Go from them right now in the name of Jesus. Every stiffness, leave now in Jesus' name. Every sickness, go in Jesus' name. Every infirmity, go in Jesus' name. Deaf spirits, go. Blind spirits, go. Damn spirits, go in the name of Jesus. Cancer, go in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Every blood complication, go in the name of Jesus. Diabetes, go in the name of Jesus. I command their hormones to normalize in the name of Jesus. I speak to thyroid glands now in the name of Jesus. Healing flow right now through the people. Right now, every pain, go now. Every pain, go now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, sickness leave and never come back. Leave the people of God now in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you. I thank you. The foul spirits have heard. The spirits of infirmity have heard. They have no choice but to obey. They have no choice but to go. Now I ask that you will restore that which only you can do. Stretch your hand now to restore. Stretch your power to restore what the enemy had damaged. Stretch your hand to restore what the enemy had attacked. In the name of Jesus, let your power flow through them at the cellular level. Let your power flow through them, through their lungs, through their pancreas, through their liver, through their hearts, through every organ in the name of Jesus, through their kidneys. In the name of Jesus, I command healing to flow. Let the power flow through them and restore them to mint condition.
Restore them to your original design for them. That which the enemy attacked, let it be restored right now by the power of the Holy Spirit. I give you praise, Lord. I give you praise, Jesus. I give you praise, Lord. Hallelujah. Now I want you to begin checking. If you had pain somewhere, begin to check. If you couldn't move your arm in a certain way, begin to move it. If your leg had a problem, begin to do what you couldn't do before in the name of Jesus. Whatever you had trouble doing before, maybe you couldn't bend, begin to bend in the name of Jesus. Sukoriyama takarabo sumbrohuto kalabasa kababa.
Christ come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome.
Now, if you don't feel the pain, lift your hand. If the condition is gone, lift your hand. Amen. You don't feel it anymore. Where was the pain? It was in your leg. It's gone. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's give Jesus glory. Amen. Now you can go and sit. Amen. You have more faith than everyone around. Hallelujah. Anyone else? Hallelujah. Because after that, then I need to minister individually to those of you who need it. A specific touch. Hallelujah. What's wrong with your shoulder? That lap has to go in Jesus' name. Give you praise, Lord. We thank you, Jesus.
Korebo ziti karababa sakateni ombre zikaye. Rikune mamro sukataye divise sukataye. I command this thing to dissolve in Jesus' name. Father, I have seen you remove tumors. I have seen tumors disappear from people's breasts. Yesterday, today, and forever, you are the same. I can feel your fire flowing through her even now. I feel a heat. It's a heat that's just going through you right now. Touch, Holy Spirit, I give you praise. Yes, there is a heat and a fire that's going through you. In Jesus' name, fire, in Jesus' name, touch, Holy Ghost, I give you praise. Touch, Lord, I give you praise. It is yours, it is yours, it is yours, it is yours. It overtakes you now in Jesus' name. It is yours, it overtakes you now in Jesus' name. Touch, Lord, I give you praise. Touch, Lord, I give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Where's the pain?
Overflow, overflow.
Overflow,
overflow,
yes.
Lift up your eyes.
world.
Your God will come with his mighty arm when you call on his name.
Father, in the name of Jesus.
He will come and save. He will come and save.
He will come.
Hey.
reigns God. Amen. Amen. Now let me tell you what's going to happen. You see, a creative miracle,
as the type, the pain is gone so that you can be able to move it. But what's going to happen is the cartilage that was removed, it's going to grow back.
Amen. The same God who's taken the pain from your knee and from your arm, he's also going to create a cartilage. And you'll be able to move it fully. Amen. Amen. How do your legs feel? Good? Completely good. Let's walk. Let's walk. I want to see you walking properly now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Feels good? Amen. Yeah, you see, I believe in, sometimes you pray and someone says there's still a little bit left. We pray again, you know? So that God gives you a full miracle. Amen. That's why we had to pray and say that even the last bit. So don't be afraid to tell me you still feel something. Amen. We'll pray again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless.
My poor.
set my feet upon the rock. I will not be, I will not be moved, and I'll say of the Lord,
you are
my shield,
my strength,
my
portion,
the devil that he's defeated. Hallelujah. Give me that crutch. I hate these things. I don't know about you, but I hate this stuff. Eh? And you know, they make it so big. Jesus. Hallelujah. You want to lift it up? It's a sign of victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He still does miracles. She was just telling me she couldn't bend the foot before. You know, they were saying they put screws and some kind of metal in there. Ooh, now the pain is gone. She can bend her foot. She's walking around with it. You know, the only reason we took off the other shoe is she came with only one shoe, you know? So she was imbalanced. Hallelujah. But this is the Jesus we serve. He does miracles, signs, and wonders. Hallelujah. Let all the other names fade away. Come on,
Jesus,
sing it.
Let all the other names fade away until they don't need you. Let all the other names fade away. Let all the other names fade away until they don't need you. Let all the other names. Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place. Let all the other names fade away. Let all the other names fade away. Till they don't leave you. Let all the other names fade away. Jesus, take your Let all the other names fade away. Let cancer fade away. Let depression fade away.
Pain go in Jesus' name. I come and
let all the
other
names fade
away. Every pain leave now. Every pain leave. What the doctors couldn't do, let the divine doctor do right now. What the surgeons could not do, let the Holy Spirit operate right now and move right in the name of Jesus. This shoulder, I command you to be healed now in Jesus'
name. Let migraine fade.
Every pain leave in Jesus' name. Every stiffness go in Jesus' name. I command the ligaments to be healed, the cartilage to be repaired right now in the name of Jesus. All healing in Jesus' name. Give you praise, Lord. Give you praise,
but Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
All the other names fade away.
Check.
No, try more. I hear the chains falling.
Feels good. Can you raise your arm?
I hear the chains.
And you feel any pain? Do you feel any pain? You feel a little. Don't go away with a little pain. Hallelujah.
I hear the chains falling.
Father, I thank you for what you have begun. Now I ask that you complete it for the glory of your name. That even any little discomfort
there
that's left will go now in Jesus'
name.
Let her have her full healing in Jesus' name.
There is power.
We give you praise and we give you glory.
In the name
there is none
Jesus.
Like you, Jesus. There is none like you, Jesus.
There is power.
Thank you, Lord.
In the name of
thank you, Jesus.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
To break every chain.
Amen.
Break every chain.
Amen.
Break every chain. To break every chain.
No pain.
Every chain.
It's fine.
Break every chain.
Hallelujah.
There's an army rising up. Yeah. There's an army. Lord, who
is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no schemes of man could ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns, oh, call me home. Here in the power of Christ has done. No power of hell, no scheme of man could ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns, oh, call me home. Here in the power of Christ.
Processing ebibadde tekyalaba colors sharpening oberengo sobolo ziraba kati dark colors zezisoka nezi nendala eziri makati brain egenda kuddamu ezitereza waliwo mwami benasabire emyezi giiseeko yali eriiso bali bikadde kyatwala kati omutu okuddamu okuyiga okuprocessing ebintu Struggling financially, but your problem is the tithe. The reason you're struggling is because you're unfaithful in the tithe. The Lord is telling me to tell you this, that if you want to get out of that financial rut in which you're stuck, you need to become faithful with the tithe. And I hear it specifically that for those of you who this message applies to, you look at your bills and you say, if I tithe, I don't know how I will manage. But God is telling you, take a step of faith. Trust him and see if he will not come through. Because already the money is not enough even when you are stealing the tithe. It's still not enough even when you are stealing the tithe. So take a step of faith and trust him with the tithe. And it would turn your whole life around. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm not even going to pray for you. This one just needs obedience. Amen. No amount of praying will change it. Only obedience will change it. Hallelujah. All I am praying, Lord, give them grace to obey. In the name of Jesus. Give them faith to just trust you and believe. In the name of Jesus. Test him and see if he will not cause the windows of heaven to open for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless you.
Abiosio, you are the God of heaven and the earth. Abiosio, Abiosio.
Kabiosi.
Kabiosi. You are the God of the heaven and the earth. Kabiosi. Kabiosi.
As the man of God.